Right, so we wait for a while till all of you come in, right? I think there were 22 or 23 participants.
No, yeah, I'm not sure.
Yes, speaking better if you can mute your microphones. Right? Mute your microphones, please. Yes, there are 27 participants on 28. Yeah. So we'll start our lesson. So when we are working with the technology, all these shortcomings are expected, right? So if there are problems in hearing, just let me know, we can sort it out easily. So today we are going to discuss the late Romantic poets or the second generation of Romantics. So when we come to this stage, England has gone through some political upheavals. There was the revolution taking place in France, and there were political changes in other countries like Ireland, right? So this social change, the fervor of social change was there all over Europe. So this change can be reflected in the poetry that these poets wrote. At the same time, they being the second generation of a previous group of poets, the ground was now prepared for them to boldly experiment with new forms and to express their thoughts and feelings more freely than of the previous generation. So the previous poets had expressed their desire for the freedom of the imagination, for the imagination to fly, to soar, to express their feelings fearlessly. So this same personal ideals were shared by these poets as well. And these poets also experimented with new styles of poetry, and they shared the predecessors' passion for liberty, and they shared the passion for nature. A devotion to nature was expressed, and also the freedom of imagination. At the same time, although they shared these characteristics with their predecessors, although they shared their same interests or the same passions with their predecessors, they were at the same time unique, right? They had their own individual characteristics as well. So whereas we could see this earlier poets a bit cloistered somewhat, they had some common features in general, these poets could be said to be very different or very individualistic in their poetry, right? Right, so we'll take a look at that, some of these poets, right? Shelley, a poet who was deeply involved and interested in the politics of his day. you can see his defense for poetry. He was at the same time a very revolutionary poet who stood out among the others. He had radical views on love, religion, socialism, and liberalism, right? Now we are moving away from the onset of the Industrial Revolution and towards a more liberalism in England. And so he was not afraid to show his desire for a new government to be established in England, one similar to that of France, where liberty and equality would reign, right? Tired of the parliamentary and the conformist rule in England at that time, he fearlessly attacked that, right? So it can be seen in his personal stance on politics would be seen in his defense of poetry. He said that poetry is the most unfailing herald of and companion and follower of the awakening of a great people to work a beneficial change. So he said, through his poetry, he tried to mobilize the people, the nation of England, towards revolution. And for this, he was not afraid. Right, anyone who has a problem hearing? Is it clear now? In all of his poems, we see, right? For example, in poems like Ozymandias, or specifically in the Ode to a West Wind, very energetically calling the people to change. He is not happy with a political stance or the lethargy of the people, not welcoming social change and not doing anything substantial or not taking action towards change. He was impatient for that change to take place in England. So he said that poetry is the most unfailing herald and the awakening. It should awaken the people to work towards change in opinion and institution. The institution in the sense in governments, right? And he said that poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. So they are the ones who call for social change, who motivate or move people towards, mobilize people towards revolution and the establishment of new governments. So with this theme in mind and with this outlook, let us try to understand his poem, England in 1819. Right, so we can see attacking the existing government and the king along with the parliament comes under his attack. We look at the tone of it, an old man, lying, despised and dying king. See the choice of words, the adjectives used to describe the king, right, starting from the word old. And declining gradually. Old, even mad, dying, and despised, and dying. King, sitting on the throne. And then the princes, the dregs of their dull race, who flow through public scorn. Mud from a muddy spoon. Right? So there's no hope here. Starting from the first line up to that semicolon in the third line. There is no hope in this system. The princes, The people who would rule after the king are themselves mud which springs from a muddy spring. So the princess, the dregs, you know the dregs, what is left over when it is straining, when the tea strains, the dregs. Once you strain the tea, you get the dregs. So the dregs of their dull race, there's nothing, no substance, no essence, no goodness in these princes, in the race. The dregs of their dull race who flow through public scorn, they are subject to the scorn of the general public, and they are nothing but the mud that is coming out of a muddy spring. So if the spring is muddy, then you will not get anything more out of it other than mud. A very vehement criticism and outrightly political, outrightly attacking the monarchy. So this, he is not afraid to show his true feelings about the king and the monarchy. And then apart from the monarchy, the rulers who neither see nor feel nor know, they have no knowledge, and since they have no knowledge of the suffering of the people, they have no sympathy or feeling about it. They do not know their countrymen and the condition of the country at that time. Not there is no suffering as such, but the need for the change. There is a need for change. So they are not sensitive to this. They are not sensitive, but each like to their fainting country king. Clinging on to their country, clinging on to their positions like leeches. It has a double meaning. So the leeches, when they cling on, very difficult to shed them. A very repulsive image there, the simile. And at the same time, sucking the blood from the people till they drop blind in blood without a blow. So it's their greed. Like the leeches, once they are full of blood, they will naturally fall off without any effort on the part of the person from whom it is sucking the blood. So without any effort, he will naturally fall. So the same thing will happen to the monarchs. Without any blow, they will fall because of their greed. It is their greed which will eventually lead to their downfall. And each like to the fainting country king. The country is fainting almost. A people starved and stabbed in the untilled field. An army whom liberticide and prey makes as a two-edged sword to all who wield. People starved and stabbed, the stir and burr sound, the starved and stabbed, the alliteration, the onomatopoeic effect of people being killed in the field. It is a reference to the revolution, the Peterloo Revolution, not actually a revolution. There was a gathering in the field where these people gathered to hear the ideas of a certain speaker who wanted to change the government, and they were supporting some reforms in the parliament. So these people's revolution or the so-called rebel was suppressed by the government at that time. So liberty is suppressed. Right, the people were stabbed in the untilled field. This is the untilled field is the reference to that field where they were, the people gathered to listen to the revolutionary ideas of the speaker. An army whom liberticide and prey. The army was used to quell this starting budding revolution. And they are at the same time two-edged swords, makes as a two-edged sword to all who wield. They are wielding the sword at the expense of the people, at the expense of liberty. So they are used by the rulers to quell the revolution. At the same time, it is a two-edged sword. Why is it a two-edged sword? They are themselves the victims of it. They all go down. There's a saying that all who wield a sword die by that same sword. So they are, the soldiers are wielding that sword, and because they are using that sword to kill liberty, they themselves die by it. Why do the soldiers die when they quell the revolution? Because in suppressing liberty, when suppressing liberty, it is them, they themselves who will be affected by it. When there is no liberty in the country, it will not be beneficial to the people, including the people in the army. Therefore, the army, they are made into a two-edged sword. Look at the word liberticide, it's a newborn word, like parricide or suicide. So killing liberty and prey makes, they are a prey, right? The prey of the monarchs and the rulers who use them as instruments to carry out their own interests. And the golden and sanguine laws which tempt and slay the corrupt legislatures. Golden and sanguine laws. So here there is satire. The golden and sanguine laws, there is nothing so much golden in them. Very outdated, obsolete laws which tempt and slay. What is the, what, why do they tempt? They are not straight, crooked, right? Tempting in the same sense, the rules are bent to serve only the interest of the rulers. If it is in their own interest, they will make a law. So the law is only interest in, only in the, it only serves the interest of the leaders or the rulers of the country, and they are used to slay those who oppose them. There is no democracy here. Anyone who is opposed in the government is slayed, and the rules are made to support this. Religion, Christless, Godless, a book sealed. The book book sealed, right? No one can open the book and read what is there. Is this what Christ preached? We never know. It is a secret. No entry, no access to know the truth. No access to the religion to know what God or Christ said. It is a closed door here, book sealed. Religion or the church at that time has become Christless and Godless. It does not become sensitive, or it is deaf to the voice of change. It is deaf to the need of change, the needs of the times, and it cannot hear. So it's a book sealed. A senate, the parliament at that time, times were statute. Unrepealed, right? Times were statute, the metaphor used. A very powerful vehicle to convey the obsolete nature of that government. Times were statute. Nothing in time had seen anything as obsolete and outdated as this. So, until our graves from which a glorious phantom may burst within our tempest day. So the whole poem is actually one complex clause. So starting from the beginning, an old man, blind, despised and dying king, and then the princess, the heirs to the throne, so the king, the princess, the rulers, and then the army, and the laws, the parliament, legislature and the senate, all of them, right? The religion, the church, all of them at a stretch. It's a list of the corrupt things that the government is made of. The state of England, the condition of England at this time. There's a list of things starting from the king up to the senate. All these are graves from which a glorious phantom may burst. So in the last two lines here, Shelley is being very optimistic all of a sudden. Our graves, from which a glorious phantom of ghosts may perhaps spring from these graves. They are nothing but graves, but perhaps from these very graves there might come a savior to illumine our tempestuous day. There might come a savior, like it gives the image of a phoenix rising from the ashes. So there is no hope in the existing system. We cannot hope any good will come out of this system. So they are graves, and it is only from the ashes of these graves, it is from these graves that a phantom or a savior might come. What does he mean? So the decaying system will one day the decaying system will one day give rise to a new ruler, a new system of government, a new body to govern England will come through the decaying system. The decaying system, which is now dying, which is on the downward hill, will give rise to a new movement, and it will give rise to a political movement, and through that movement, like in France, it will give birth to a more better, more stable, more promising government and a brighter future for England. So if you look at the tone of the poem, what can you say here? An old, mad, blind, despised and dying king. The princes, the dregs of their dull race, mud from a muddy spring. Very disillusioned poet, very emotionally involved in this situation, in the politics, right? And he is not, it's a very genuine outburst of the poetry. Not like the poetry of Wordsworth, not the emotions distilled to reflection here, right? Very emotional, and an emotional outburst, an emotional reaction to the condition of England. It's very genuine. And that is where the beauty of the poem is. There is no kind of trying to hide or soften the feelings of the poet. So the beauty is there, in the very sincerity of this emotional outburst, in the energy of it. The energy is in the sincerity of the poet. You can almost hear the angry growl of the people, right? There is a stir underneath. They are saying, like, at the surface, of course, at the top, we can see the rulers, the dying king at the top. But underneath, there is the steady growl, the roar of the people who are unhappy with this. The revolution is there. So that is very much there in the tone of the poet. And he is, of course, an idealist. So that is what we see in the last two lines of his poem. It is full of hope, although he is criticizing, right? There is also a small streak of similarity to Blake, who outrightly criticizes. But at the same time, there is hope for a better future. Very optimistic and idealistic. So the idealism runs high in the poem. There is no shallow display of anger. His anger is very vehemently displayed. And also very authentic, very original. So that's why I said the poets are very unique. Right? There is, although influenced by the previous generation, it is not a copying or adhering to a tradition. No, this is very individualistic, very authentic. And moreover, there is authority in his voice. It's a young voice. These poets died when they were young. And the authority, of course, these are not concretely political, right? Although they are heralding a revolution and calling for rebel or calling for social change, these are not concretely political poems, but at the same time, there's authority in his voice, sincerity, and originality in the tone of his poem. The poem reaches a climax until the word graves. Where is this? Right, it gathers momentum. An old man done this first king, the princes, the gods of the race, and the rulers who are leech-like, and the people who are starved and stabbed in the until field, and the army who are themselves victims and who victimize others, the golden and sanguine laws. Sorry, each everyone is a pile up of the corrupted nature of England at that time. Each line piles on to a hopeless situation. So the Senate piles up on the region, and that piles up on the golden and sanguine laws, and on top of that the army, and on top of that we see the people who are starved, and then the rulers who are making all of it a misery, and then the princes, and then the king. So everything, they come to a climax, and the word there, graves, it's the culminating climax there. All of these are graves, and from that, although it's a climax, it's also kind of an anti-climax perhaps. They are all moving downhill, and through that, from once they hit the rock bottom, there is the rising of the glorious phantom, the savior who is going to change it all, who may burst to illumine our tempestuous day. Shelley's other poems, especially Ode to a West Wind, also very energetic and very powerful in a poem. Yeah, you can almost hear the storm because of the onomatopoeic effect of the words and the alliteration used. Right? Heralding the revolution, heralding the storm. It is very impatient. So here also we get a slight tone of that impatience of the revolution. What words, what are the words which signify the poem? If you look at the overall tone of it, words carefully chosen to create a dismal picture of the English government, and more generally, create a very dismal picture of the condition of England in 1819. The very adjectives, it is in the power of the adjectives, the carefully chosen adjectives are the words which give create this dull picture. The words poor man, lying, despised and dying, these are all adjectives. The dull words, the public scorn. The muddy spring, the unsympathetic, the leech-like rulers, and then the onomatopoeic effect here, starved and stabbed until healed, the stir and burst sounds there, it creates the effect of killing, right, how people are stabbed. How they are sound or when they are stuck to death. And the two-edged sword, all these, the golden sanguine lord, priceless and godless region, all these are carefully chosen adjectives which show the corrupted nature of the rule at that time. Language is at very vivid. right? The images are vivid and very emphatic tone is there. It's very personal, at the same time very revolutionary, right? Although it is although it's a revolutionary thing, it's political, it's public, but at the same time it shows that Shelley has taken it very personally. It's a personal cry for freedom and liberty. Shelley and C. Shelley, as in other poems, stirring up the people or trying to mobilize the people towards change or to revolt, to a revolt. Just as much as a poem of disillusionment, it is also a poem of hope. What do you think? Is it a poem of hope or a poem of despair? Yes, it can everyone hear, first of all? If you can hear, I think the screen is unnecessary because the poem is with you after all. And whatever is on the slides, I am reading it. Okay. If you, there is a problem in hearing, just let me know, right? Anything else, it's not unnecessary. If the hearing is not clear, just let me know. Just put up your hand and let me know. What can you, is it a poem of despair or of hope? I think it's much more a poem of hope, right? There is disillusionment in the first couplet. It's a sonnet, it's in the sonnet form, it's a sonnet actually. In the first 10 lines, there is disillusionment. It seems that Shelley is saying there is no hope for us, that everything is a closed door. Each line piles up disillusionment on the preceding line. So everywhere in every line we see the disillusionment or despair of the poet. But at the same time, especially in the last two lines, there is hope, right? There is a sentence of hope. It is very hopeful of the future and it signals the need for change. Here Shelley is trying to tell the people that this system is not working for us. We need to change. There is a dire need to change. Shelley's other poems, especially Ode to the West End and Asimandias, it shows his political stance or his political involvement in England at that time. The politics of the country, the government is in shambles, right? So that's what he's saying. And if you look at the form, it does not follow the proper form of a sonnet, not the proper rhyming scheme. So it is perhaps Shelley's inventing of Shelley bending the form to express his ideas, or maybe it is a reflection of the broken condition of England. England is apparently not in good shape.
Ma'am, it's coming. Vibrating, ma'am.
So, is it a disturbance in the lecture? So, what I will do is,
I think your network is very low. It is struggling. Sometimes your voice is vibrating.
No, because it happens from time to time, I think. this kind of problem, I think once also it was there and we had to stop the lecture. And but later on, after like 10 minutes, it came back. So what shall we do then? Shall we postpone the lecture again to another day? I think that is the best option, isn't it? Because if you can't say, there is no use of doing the lecture. Is it clear up to now?
No, madam. If you are not sharing the screen, I think it will be all right. Shall we check like that?
Okay. Right. So let me check the time now. 39 minutes. See, we will do 40 minutes. So we'll do for 1 hour, and if I will not share the screen. And if the problem is still persisting, we will after 1 hour, we will, after discussing Shelley, we will finish it off. Okay. Otherwise, if it is disturbing and there are messages here and there also, what kind of thing? Then there is no point in continuing the lecture. Where is, you can't hear, isn't it? Not a problem with the connection as such, because once we checked, there was this problem, and we checked the connection and it was fine. And the following day we did another lecture and there was no problem at all.
We'll, if all can mute their mics, it's better, man.
Yes, so that is, I think the mics are muted, so it's your responsibility. Can you all try, right? We will try to make the lecture work and then mute the mic. All of you can mute your mic and see whether you can cooperate, and see whether we can go at least for 1 hour. So if we can go till 1 hour, we'll continue. Otherwise, we will stop. Right? Is that okay with everyone? No objections?
Okay, madam.
Right. Yes, who is the one who unmuted the microphone now? Sometimes happens, all of a sudden they, you unmute the mic. Then I think there is a vibration kind of thing. It's not really my fault, right? If you want to say something, you can use the chat box. But if there is a question and answer session, I will say that you have time for your questions or your comments, then you can unmute your mic and speak. So until then, you must keep the mics muted, because there are around 35 participants. So if you all unmute your mics, it's going to create a huge noise. So please don't unmute your mics unless there is a urgent need to do so. Right. So this poem highlights Shelley's involvement in England's politics at that time and his view of how England was in
1819. And in 1819, England was corrupted by the King George, no? And
yes, good. Thank you. For
and Shelley wanted to attack, verbally, against that corruption of King George.
Yes, that is.
He wants to criticize. So what is exactly going in England? Is it so?
Yes. So as you said, because the king at this time was King George the Third, right? And he is the one who is criticized here as such, and the princess. Prince who came afterwards, George the Fourth, after the death of the king. So no hope at all in the lineage. And as I said earlier, the sonnet does not follow the rhyming scheme of other sonnets. And how Keats has used this, the form of the sonnet, to show the condition of England at that time. It doesn't fit into the conventional sonnet form. Maybe he is this complete disregard the sonic form or perhaps maybe he used that to show that Indian was falling. Right? It was falling in pieces, in shambles. And what are the literary devices used here, if we can see? As I said, there is the onomatopoeic effect and the proper choice of words, especially the in the choice of the adjectives to describe the falling condition, the obsolete nature of the rulers, the outdated laws, the corrupt system. All these are shown in the choice of the vocabulary, in the choice of words.
And he used us similes, no? Like leak, leech.
Yes, leech-like. Right?
Like a sucking blood that represents the government oppression, no?
Yes, that is it. It symbolizes the oppression of the government, right? Sucking the blood, sucking the life of the people. Living off the people but not giving anything in return, right? Through the taxes and suppressing the oppression of the monarchy. So the word the glorious phantom, that is contrasted with the previous words. Earlier the portrayal of a dismal and gloomy England contrasted with the glorious phantom. If he does not specify who it is, but maybe he is referring to a new ruler, like in France, waiting in expectation, and words like glorious and illumined, all contrasted with the grey picture of England portrayed in the previous stanzas. So you can say that there are contrasting words, and through the words, through the choice of words, two contrasting images of England are portrayed. One, a gloomy and dull, grey England, and which is the present. And in the future, there is the vision of a very glorious, prosperous, bright future for England in the future. So these two images of the present and the future in England are contrasted to bring out the effect, the hope, effect of hope, which is present in the last two lines. Tempestuous, right? That it's feeling the sensation of revolt, of revolution, to end the tyrannical rule and to bring about a new system of government. Sense of revolution is also brought forward by the tempestuous day. And there are words which, images which signal death and decay. Graves, isn't it? Blood. Of course, that is also a blood is a thing. Blood and sword, these are images of suppression. But words like graves, dull rays, dregs, fainting, they give a dismal picture of a crumbling England.
Two-edged sword, what does it symbolize?
Two-edged sword, right? There is a confusion here, right? We cannot specifically see, are not very clear, but according to my opinion, I think the two-edged sword, the soldiers wielding a two-edged sword means they victimize people. They are the ones who kill the people, but at the same time, they are themselves killed, because when they kill the people, they are killing liberty. They are killing freedom. So when freedom and liberty is killed, the soldiers themselves are killed, because with liberty and with freedom, they will also be saved. Now the soldiers are the people who are in the middle. They are not neither the rulers nor the common people. So
they are there can never be a winner in the battlefield. That means both parties are, I mean, they're having as a battle, like the civilians and the rulers. But no one is winners there, no? Is that so?
No one is?
No winners. There can be never be a winners in the battle.
Yeah. So when the revolution is suppressed, although the political rulers will win, there is no actual victory. That is also one thing. And as you said, when there is a battle between the soldiers and the common people, the soldiers are the intermediary. They are in the middle. They are acting on behalf of the rulers, and they are not acting on behalf of their own free will. Not out of their own free will. It is not their personal thing to go and quell the revolt. But they are doing it on behalf of the rulers. So when people like these intermediaries, people who are caught in the middle, are used as instruments, they are affected at both ends. They are used by the rulers, so that is a two-edged sword. They are carrying a two-edged sword. They are killing the people. From the people also they get killed, and by the rulers also they get killed. So they are both victimized. One thing is they are victimized at both, by both ends, by the rulers and by the people, because the people are also against them, and at the same time the rulers also are not on their side, because the soldiers, they also want freedom, they don't want liberty, they don't want the tyrannical rule. So the monarchs are not going to address their needs. The soldiers are only the instruments. So because of that, the rulers are also victimizing them. So at both ends, they are suppressed. That could be this two-edged sword. And at the same time, when the soldiers are killing liberty, when they are quelling the revolution, they are killing themselves in that. By quelling the revolution, by killing other people, they are killing themselves. By committing liberticide, they are killing themselves. Because when liberty is killed, they also will get killed. Liberty is for everyone, including the soldier. Everyone is going to benefit from democracy except the rulers. So the soldiers also, the army is also going to benefit from from democracy. But because they are acting on behalf of someone else, the revolution, when they are quelling the revolt, and because they are killing liberty, they are themselves being killed by that. So that could be the two-edged sword here. Right. So is it clear now, the last 10 minutes, apart from that cry of the gecko there? Is anything, is everything clear? Can we continue, or shall we call off the lecture for another day?
No,
now is okay, madam.
All right.
Once you try to switch off something in your computer, I think it came all right. Maybe the speakers.
Maybe there is something shaking.
I don't know.
Just unplug your headset and plug it again, then it will be okay, I think.
What is it?
So now it's clear, madam.
All right.
Now it's very clear.
Okay. Right. So let's hope that it will go on for say 1 or 2 more hours, right? Right. Then we'll move on to the other poet whom I love, who is John Keats. So a very different poet. And here in Keats, we find a very philosophical poet whose rich poetry has contributed a lot to romantic, English romantic poetry, right? I think no other poet has been ever able to capture the transience of life, the transience of everything actually, of beauty, of youth, of love, and of life itself. How everything is just passing away. And it is, of course, other poets also lamented this decay and the passing of beauty and the transience of things. But here is a very deeply philosophical and personal voice that comes in Keith's poetry. At the same time, using a lot of sensuous, luxuriant images, he is a very sensuous poet. He lives and describes and his ideas and he achieves his, he approaches his themes through sensuous imagery, and appealing to all five senses, right? Approaches all his themes through the feelings. The feelings which are transient. So when we come to the end of the poem, where we find the abstract theme, we find the diminution of the senses. We'll look at it deeply, when we will see it deeply when we try to study his poems. When we, it be the, for example, Autumn. Poem to Autumn, it starts with luxuriant images, sensuous images, but along with that, when the poem progresses, we find these images, the sense of touch, the sense of smell disappears, and gradually the senses are silenced, and then we have get the idea, the abstract idea is then projected at that moment when the feelings are put to sleep, right? So we'll have a look at this. Just give me a minute to adjust the computer's battery, right? It is going down. Just give me 1 minute. Right, so we have been given only one poem. To Autumn is the poem that we have, that is prescribed for us in the syllabus. It's a beautiful poem. But if you have time, please read the other two poems as well. The three odes. You can ode to a nightingale and ode to a Grecian urn. Right, where he discusses the transience of life. Right. Hey, look. I don't have a copy of the book. Yes. It begins. It's an ode. An ode to Autumn. And so the ode addresses, written as an address to a person. So an ode to a nightingale. Ode to a Grecian urn. Ode to Autumn. It begins with the season. The season of autumn, it begins with a description of it. Season of mist and mellow fruitfulness, first bosom friend of the maturing sun. Yes, so this is what I love in Keats, the sensuous imagery. Bosom friend of the maturing sun. The sun is maturing. Now coming to a stage where he is breathing the harvest, a mature person. Now, if you compare the stages, the seasons for persons status in life, a person in childhood and then in what you call in his adolescence, youth, and then come to an age of maturity. So this is a season which is rich in harvest, where the person is enjoying his achievements. So autumn is a season like that now. It's a season of peace and mellow fruitfulness. There is the feeling of fruitfulness, of achievements, right? And the bosom friend of the maturing son, very close friend. He does not say it's a close friend, but a bosom friend, right? So a feeling of relaxation, of relaxing in the sun. Enjoy the sun here, the maturing sun, and conspiring with him how to load and bless with fruit the vines that round the that yields run. So very playfully, imagining that there's the flight of imagination. The sun and the season is conspiring how to bless the people. Now they have worked hard during the previous seasons, so let's conspire how to bless them now, how to give them the reward, how to bless the with fruit the vines that round the thatch eaves. How shall we bless them with fruits? To bend the apples, it apples the musk cottage trees, the cottage trees that the trees in the cottages, the cottage gardens, how we can fill them and how we can bend them with apples, right? It's not just filled with apples, but it, because of the weight of the fruit, the tree is bent. So it's a rich harvest here. And fill all fruit with ripeness to the core. All the fruits are ripe to the core, right? Plump. And to swell the food and plump the hazel shells. Here we get the sense of touch in the first sense. The gourd is swelled and the hazel shells are plump. With a sweet kernel to set budding more and still more. Later flowers for the bees. There are more flowers for the later bees, right? Still, still some flowers are blooming. Although it's autumn, it's not yet dying, right? No, still no sign of winter. So there are some flowers, and we get the beautiful image of August or the August season, where we have the flowers and the fruits, and everything is really ripe, and we get the smell of the fruits. When the fruits are ripening, there's a sweet smell in the air. And look at the ending line. Still more later flowers for the bees, until they think warm days will never cease, for summer has overbrimmed their famine self. So the very irony of the two lines. The bees will think summer will never end. So isn't that the feeling of people of when we are successful, the thought that all this is coming to an end, it doesn't enter the people's minds. So the people think the days of happiness will never end, right? So even now here in the first stanza, there is Keats tries to fill the poem with images of harvest, of fruitfulness, of fulfillment, happiness and joy, right? All these feelings are invoked in the first stanza, but in even in the first stanza there is the undercurrent notion that this is not going to be everlasting. There is undercurrent tone of transience, because he says until they will think that warm days will never end. They think that it will never end, but soon we see it is going to come to an end. Then in the second stanza, who has not seen the oft amid thy store? Who has not seen autumn amid thy store? Who has not seen the season of autumn? In other words, who is a person who has not seen success or happiness? Everyone has come to a stage, everyone has experienced a stage in his life where he has experienced happiness, fullness, maturity. And Sometimes, whoever seeks a god may find thee sitting careless on a granary floor, where the grains are kept. So here, carelessly sitting, right? No thought of any robbery, no thought of death or of impeding danger. So enjoying the harvest and lulled by the success and the fruitful harvest, the image of a satisfied person. Like how afflicted by the winnowing wind, right? So the image of a girl that is almost half asleep or on half reed furrow, sound asleep, drowsed with the fume of poppies while thy hook tears the next swath and all its green flowers, right? Now, the image of a girl sitting carelessly on the granary floor and the hair is uplifted by the winnowing wind. Winnowing in the sense, there's the winnowing fan, right? So when the chaff is where the chaff is separated from the grain. Now here there are gradually cases introducing images of a very say not ominous but different nature from the first stanza. The winnowing is separating chaff from the grain. Right? There is a kind of a end thing. Some end is symbolized here. Or on a half-reed furrow, sound asleep, drowsed with the fume of poppies, right? So half-drugged with the smell of the poppy flowers, while your hoof has the next spot and all its twined flowers. So the image of reaping the harvest, and while you take the next swap with your hook, and then because of that smell, you are half drugged. And sometimes, like a leaner thou dost keep, steady thy laden head across a brook. Right? Sometimes you are steady. So people at this age, sometimes they are drugged with happiness, with the bountiful nature of that age. They are sometimes drugged with happiness. And maybe because of the excess, they are now careless, right? So they are left, maybe not very careful, but carefree, and at the same time relaxing a kind of lethargic nature because of the fruitfulness itself, right? But also sometimes you are steady, right? Steadily moving towards something. Steady thy laden head across a brook, or by a cedar press, with patient look, thou watchest the last oozing hours by hours. Right? Now you must know that when Keats wrote his three odes, he was at this time dying of tuberculosis. So these two contrasts, right? Shifting moods of the poet. At the same time, there is fullness, maturity, beauty, enjoying the pleasures of life. And at the same time, death, decay, the passing of time, the transience of everything that is beautiful. So the last oozing, hours by hours, oozing, life is oozing. He is dying now. So that is the experience that comes out here. So, of course, people are lethargic, right? Enjoying the happiness, enjoying the bliss. But at the same time, life is oozing little by little, right? So it's obviously his personal experience that gives color to his poems. But at the same time, this theme is universal because when everyone is enjoying happiness, automatically without knowing what is happening is that happiness is fleeing. It is oozing hour by hour, that happiness is fleeing. It's very transient. That's the same thing. When you say that you are enjoying your success, at the same time, it means that the success is fleeing. So, what is the last losing hour by hour? You watch the happiness, the life being taken away from you drop by drop. So it's very painful because Keith was dying, but it is of course universal human nature. Where are the songs of spring? where are they? Think not of them. Thou hast thy music too. You too have your music. So where is the joy of spring? Of course, this is very fruit of the song of a very fruitful fruitful harvest. You are reaping the harvest. But at the same time, now there is the impending doom of winter, right? Once you have reached achieved the harvest, then it's the time for death now. Once the harvest is there, it's the time for the end of it. So where is the joyful expectation that comes with spring? It's a rhetorical question, and it awakens the reader to the impending gloom of winter, of death, of transience of things. But the poet, he averts that, right? He, at least on the surface, he tries to bypass that question and say, do not think of them. You have your own music, right? But it is there. The feeling that the end is close, it is there. While bird clouds bloom the soft dying day and touch the subtle plains with rosy hue. Bloom the soft dying day. So the dying, softly dying, right? Gradually, noiselessly coming to an end. And touch the subtle plains with rosy hue. So even the death is beautiful. There is the rosy hue. Then in a wailful fire, the small nuts moan. Now there is the mourning of the insects. Maybe when there's the humming of the bees, right? When they are leaving their nests. When the fruits are ripe, the insects are the bees, especially those who live on the nectar, right? They leave their nest and they may be they are swarms of bees. So that sound, the hum of the bees, right? It's like a wailful fire. The image of a funeral is evoked. And then in a wailful choir, the small nuts mourn among the river sallows, mourn aloft, or sinking as the light wind lives or dies. So the wind is living and dying. Sometimes the wind is there, blue wind very well. Sometimes it is a dying wind. So the swallows are flying on the wind. They move down when the wind is not much. And sometimes they so high. So the light wind, living and dying. Now, the season of autumn is coming to a close and we are moving towards the season of winter. And full-grown lambs love beat from hilly bone. So can you remember I told you that image of the bleating lamb? The lamb is an innocent animal, so he is taken to slaughter here. But to take his wool, right? Finch crickets sing, and now with trebles up, so the beating of the lambs, right? The pain. And then fetch the scene, and now with trebles of the red whistles from a garden crop, and gathering swallows twitter in the skies. So the poem ends, does not end with a very ominous, or what you call, it is not so much a depressing tone, but it ends with a undercurrent tone of death. There is the notion of approaching death, right? If you go through the, if you analyze the imagery used in each of these stanzas, in the first stanza we get the sense of touch from the hazel shells. Of course, there is the what you call the onomatopoeic effect there. Plump the hazel shells, swell the gourd, right? Tactile imagery. Moss cottage trees, moss swelled gourd, and budding trees, and the bosom friend, overbring their clammy cells, right? All specific sensuous imagery, specifically imagery of the sense of touch, right? Most immediate of the senses, nearly feel it on our skin first. Right, so the most immediate of the senses is approached there. Then when it comes to the second stanza, what is the dominant image that is used here? Who has not seen keenly of the midnight stone? Sometimes whoever seeks abroad may find deep seeking starless on a granary floor. So images, visual images of sense of touch, that is the one that we feel most with. Sense of sight, it's more distant, right? And then also the sense of last sense of a very distant sense, the sense of sound, the songs of spring, the music, and the beating of the faraway beating of the lambs, and the humming of the bees, right? Because singing, the distant sense of sound is used there in the last sense. Right? So gradually becoming distant to signal the gradual ebbing away of life. See how beautifully he handles the imagery, the technique, the language. Neatly fits into the structure of an ode. But it is not as very, how would you say, it doesn't bring the very transience of nature. It is very remotely approached and discussed here in this poem. So the image in the second stanza is that of a girl, right? I don't know whether I highlighted it well enough. This girl sitting on the granary floor with the hair softly lifted by the wind, and with a winnowing fan in her hand. So that the winnowing fan, of course, also brings the image of the reaper, right? The reaper, the grim reaper, we meet him towards the end of life. Now it is the time to reap or sow the harvest, separate the chaff from the grain, separate the good from bad, keep the good and throw away what is unnecessary and not good. And drowse with the fume of poppies. Here also we get the sense of smell. The fume of poppies. And the steady image of the head laden across a brook or by a cedar press, who is sitting near the press and near the wine press and watching the drops of wine come through the press. Thou watchest the last oozing hours by hours. The image of piece of this wine press keeper at the same time watching the life being taken away from you gradually. So you are watching your own death, right? At this piece was at the same time haunted by his own brother's death at this time. And he himself was dying at a young age from tuberculosis. Again, at the same time, along with the romantics, he idealizes nature. The beauty of the season of autumn is brought out, and that season is used to represent a season in the human, the life of every person. A very personal poem, and which brings out the sad quality, the sadness of his premature death, and at the same time it has a universal significance, because each person's success and each person's happiness is immediately or gradually or soon after followed by the end of happiness and the end of joy and the end of life. So the transience of things, it is signaled in this poem towards the end of the poem. Even in the first stanza, it is the season of mist. The mist is something that appears and disappears. So sometimes sometimes mist, it gives an obscurity, right? Sometimes it may be obscure. So perhaps people are drugged by this success. That is why he uses that image there. Mist you think that it is not, and you do not see the what is coming ahead of you. Now, if there is a mist on the road, you do not know what is ahead of you. So, if there is a mist, you see only the immediate environment. What is he in front of your nose, you will see. So, you think your success is like that. And that it will end soon does not enter your mind. So, that is the nature of the mist. But when it disappears, then the vision of the end, it comes into view. Right? So, it is a season of mist. This period of harvest, of abundance, is also a period of deception, isn't it? Because of the abundance, you are deceived. You think that happiness, warm days, your happiness, their warm days will never end. So it is also a season of deception. So maybe that is why he calls it a season of mist. And also fruitfulness. Of course, the fruitfulness is there, but it is soon disappearing. So the theme of almost all Keats's poems is the transience of abundance, the transience of beauty, transience of life. Right? It comes out in this way. He uses the natural images to bring out that deep philosophy of life. And if we move on to the other poem, Ode to a Grecian Urn. Now here, yes, Ode to a Grecian Urn. Here it is a slightly different theme, how he immortalizes art, right? So two contrasted things, art and human life are contrasted. So this is also the theme in the Ode to a Nightingale. The beauty of nature or the beauty of something eternal is compared to the transient beauty of life. Life is impermanent, whereas art is permanent, right? Art has the quality to preserve beauty, whereas life does not have that ability to hold something. It cannot hold on to things. Whereas art, as symbolized by the urn, the art has the ability to preserve things, to eternalize and to immortalize beauty, love, life, anything. Right? And anything that is beautiful can be preserved in art and also in nature, right? As in the Ode to a Nightingale, the nightingale's singing his songs have the eternal quality, will not decay. Whereas the human life which enjoys this beauty is coming to an end. So on the one side, lamenting the end of life, which cannot enjoy things eternally, and on the other hand, rejoicing because something can be preserved in art or in nature. Right? So we'll see how this dichotomy is brought out in the poem. Ode to a Grecian Urn, I think I have sent you the poem, right? Thou still unravished bride of quietness, thou foster child of silence and slow time. Why unravished? It's an unravished bride, very pure, uncorrupted by time. Time has not touched this urn, in the sense art cannot, time cannot corrupt art or it cannot affect art in any way. Whereas life is affected by time. Quietness, right? It is very quiet, right? Elegant. Use the image of a bride. In silence, in elegance, she is, she has a lot of things, possesses a lot of qualities, very quiet in that sense. And foster child of silence and slow time, right? Time passes slowly for him. Time does not affect the urn because it is not decaying. And silence, right? In silence, it is saying something. Now, human life, is it silent? No, it is full of noises. What are the noises? Of thoughts, of emotions, everything that comes and goes. So human life is full of noises. It is subject to turbulent changes. But the urn represents all these changes in silence. It bears all these things in silence. And it's a silent representation of beauty, of eternity. Silver historian, so it has a lot of memories of the past. Now it has maybe been there for centuries. Right? So it has seen the changes of maybe 100 years. So it has the knowledge of a historian. Right, but it has the knowledge, but it is silent. He keeps the ideas to himself. Who can thus express a flowery tale more sweetly than our rhyme? So perhaps this Grecian urn can say something of our history more than our flowery hymns or more than our flowery poetry can say. Our poetry is full of noise, but in the silence of the urn, he can maybe say something much more beautiful about the history of the human race. And then see the flight of the imagination. What leaf-fringe legend haunts about the shape of deities or mortals or of gods, right? So if you have seen the Grecian urn, these huge vases, tall vases, well, they have ornamented figures of beautiful tales. So looking at these images, Keith is imagining, are these deities mortals or immortals, or what are they, right? What do these mortals or deities, what stories do they tell? What are the legends? Or maybe both of them are there. What leaf-fringed legend haunts about thy shape of deities, of mortals, or of both? In temp or the dales of Arcady, right? What men or gods are these? What maidens lot? What mad pursuit? What struggle to escape? What pipes and trimbles? And so what maidens lot? What mad pursuit? So maybe there is a lover pursuing a girl. And then and a struggle to escape. Someone is trying to escape something. Right? Maybe the girl is running away. And what pipes and trimbles? What wild ecstasy? So maybe there's a procession, right? People playing instruments, pipes, right? So what wild ecstasy is portrayed here? Now these are the joys of a life. It is not the joy of art. Art cannot enjoy these things. But some human being who enjoyed these things in life has portrayed them on the urn. So the urn is immortalizing or preserving the joys or the ecstasy of a human being, of the human life, right? So what wild ecstasy? Everything is captured here in the urn and the struggle to escape. So although it is now, although Keats is describing the pictures of an urn, these are actually the woes or the struggles of human life itself, right? The maidens got the man pursuit, right? The people are pursuing love, they are in search for love, honor, or in search of beauty, in search of power. And then there is the struggle to escape. To escape what? To escape death. Everyone is trying to become immortal. So see the dichotomy in the words men or gods, deities or mortals, right? The dichotomy of life and death. On the one hand, there is the deity, the immortal person, and the other hand, the dying person, the human being. And then the gods and men, immortal gods and the dying men. So the duality of the human existence is portrayed. And what wild ecstasy, right? Heard melodies are sweet, but unheard, those unheard are sweeter. Therefore, ye soft pipes play on, not to the sensual ear, but more endeared, play to the spirit, it is of no tone, right? The imagination. Now, you can't hear what the players are playing. The procession, in the procession, pipers are playing the music. Heard melodies are sweet, but those that are unheard, that means those melodies that are imagined, are still sweeter. So that is the longing of life. You have experienced or enjoyed life, but you still long for more. Now, his experience is that he's dying at a premature age. So there is still more for him to enjoy. So that is still more beautiful. That longing, that desire is still more beautiful than what he enjoyed. So here is the pure flight of imagination. The imagined melodies are still sweet. Therefore, you play not to the sensual ear. The images on the vase are not appealing to the sensual ear, but they are more endeared. They are more beloved because they to the spirit. It is of no tone. They play to the imagination. They are appealing to the imagination. That is why they are beautiful, isn't it? If we see anything on a vase, the pictures on a vase, it is beautiful not because so much because we can hear, but we imagine the story and the music that is behind those pictures in the vase. And then again, fair youth beneath the trees, thou cannot leave thy song, nor ever can those trees be there. Pictures of beautiful youth. You cannot leave your song, nor can those trees be there. The winter cannot shed the leaves. Leaves in the trees cannot fall off due to winter season. And the youth cannot leave the song. He will be forever singing that song in the urn. And bold lover, never, never can thou kiss, though winning ever near the goal. Yet do not grieve. She cannot fade, though thou hast not thy bliss, forever will thou love, and she be fair. Right? So in that art, the thing is preserved, youth is preserved. So in that, he is addressing the youth in that verse and saying, you cannot kiss her, but do not lament it, because she will always be fair, and though you have not, you will never have the pressure of kissing her, she will always be there, and you will always be close to her, because that moment is captured in time in that past. You will forever love her, she will remain the same. So there is this theme of unconsummated passion there. Then in the next stanza, are happy, happy boughs that cannot shed your leaves, nor ever bid the spring adieu. Right? So it's a continuation. That spring has been, the moment has been captured and silenced in time. And happy melodies, unwearied, not tired, right? Forever piping songs, forever new. For every person who sees the urn, it's a new melody. Imagine a new melody. More happy love. And more happy, happy love, forever warm and still to be enjoyed, forever panting and forever young, right? The passion, and forever young, all breathing human passion far above, that leaves a heart high, sorrowful and cloyed, a burning forehead and a parching tongue, right? So the intensity of the fever. Now, he is a burning forehead and a parching tongue. The tongue is dry. And so when he is having a high fever, these are the things that he goes through. The pain of the mortal figure, the pain of the dying person, and the immortality in art. The dichotomy is always brought out. Who are these coming to the sacrifice? To what green altar, mysterious place? So like as in the previous poem, gradually moving away to death, who are these coming to the sacrifice? Maybe some priests are taking the cow towards the temple. To what green altar? Leave thou that heifer lowing at the skies. So that there's a heifer that is being dragged to the temple. And all her silken plants with garlands dressed. So you see, it's a symbol of a sacrifice. And when reflecting the death of the poet himself. But little town by river or seashore or mountain built with that peaceful citadel, right? So the church also may be coming closer to the funeral. Is emptied of this folk, this pious mound. So the church is empty of people, right? A gloomy church of the gloomy citadel is portrayed. Now it is empty of people. Therefore, they are not there now. What is that? Is it because of its sacrifice and there's a hyper being dragged to a maybe sacrifice? And little town that speaks forevermore will silently, and not a soul to tell why thou art desolate can ever return. So no one can say why you have become silent here. So he will soon be silent, his impending death signal. And oh, at it shaped the attitude with greed of marbled men and maidens overwrought, the earnest overwrought hill of full with marble men and maidens, with forest branches and weeds. And thou silent form, the tease us out of thought, right? Like in the previous poem, you tease us out of thought, as with eternity. Just as much as the thought of eternity deceives us, this urn also deceives us. It teases us. It is mocking at us because we are mortals, we are dying. And in silence, he is mocking at us and deceiving us because it is giving thoughts of eternity for us. Cold pastoral, so that in that he is very cold. He is coldly and unsympathetically mocking the poet through his eternity. The verse is eternal, whereas the poet is dying. So it's a cold pastoral, right? The urn is depicted as a cold friend because he brings out the lack of eternity in the poet's life. When old age shall this generation waste, thou shalt remain in midst of other woe than ours, a friend to man, to whom thou sayest, beauty is truth, and truth is beauty. That is all you need, no honor, and all you need to know. Right? So you will forever mock the generation of men. When this generation has gone, for more generations, there will be more generations of people. So you will tell them that beauty is truth. What is the truth? That everything is transient. Right? So you will be reminding the future generations of that truth, that everything is not eternal in time, everything passes away. Only the imagination can sow and capture those beautiful things in time. But art is capturing some moments in time and preserving them, and in that art has immortalized something. But human life is not immortal, it is dying, it is passing away. So that truth will always be reminded to people by the urn. The urn will stand in time, in eternity, and tell all generations, it will remind all generations of this truth, that life is transient and passing away. Right? So please read Keats' other poem, which is Ode to a Nightingale, where he outrightly says that fancy cannot fade thou deceiving us. The nightingale is seen as a person who is deceiving, but he says you cannot deceive me, because although your melody or song is sweet, it is not eternal. And that melody makes his imagination soar, and in his imagination he soars and enjoys, but when he comes back to the reality, it is again the reality of pain, death, suffering, all that is part of human nature. On the personal level, it is suffering because pain and death is part of the poet's life. But at the same time, death, decay, human agony, fever, the mad pursuit, the passion, all that is characteristic of human life. Whereas it is not the case of nature or of art, right? It is not passing away, so there is no mad pursuit, because it is going to outlive time. So if it is going to stand in eternity, there is no mad pursuit. That is the theme of most of Keats' poems. He's a very philosophical poet, and his philosophical outlook of life is apparent in almost all his poems. It's very rich in detail at the same time. Yes, anything else? What are the images used? As I think we discussed images in Fall to Autumn. Now, in both the past papers that we got, we do not have a chance to talk about Byron and Keats because of the poems. Yeah, but this time you might get some poems, some questions on these two poets as well, right? So try to study them as well. Right. Any questions here? Now you can, it's time for you to unmute your mics, and then if you have any questions.
Madam, should we study both, madam? Is the second one in the syllabus?
No, the second one is not in the syllabus.
Uh-huh.
Right, I just did it because I like the poet. That is why I did that. But no need to study, but if you can, it's better always. Right?
Okay, madam. Thank you.
I don't know what the question will be like. Now, Keats' theme is very unique. No other poet has discussed that aspect of life, the philosophical outlook of life, that his perspective is very unique. And even Shelley and Byron, right? So that is why it's difficult to find a common question to encompass all three. Right? You cannot find a person who has addressed politics as much as Shelley has done. It's not in the syllabus. There are other poets, but not in the syllabus. So, of course, Blake did, but his poems were not specifically addressed to a certain group of people. In general, he criticized the evils of the day. But Shelley was specifically attacking the politics of England, the state who ruled at that time. So they are in their own way unique. If you can, remember or memorize some lines from Ode to a Nightingale also, because it's such a beautiful poem. And the theme is very apparent. The transience of life is very apparent in that poem, more than in this Grecian. But that poem is very, readers find that poem a little bit difficult to understand. That is why I thought of discussing the Grecian. But even in the Grecian Urn, that dichotomy of life and death, the transience of life and life versus death, immortal gods versus mortal men, and the transience of life and everything that is decaying versus the imagination, right? The imagination versus the harsh reality. Everything is embodied in that Grecian urn. But if you want for nature, all romantics were very appreciative of nature. Even Shelley used borrowed images from nature to herald his political ideas. Now, for example, in Ode to the West Wind is used, that is a storm, is used to symbolize the revolution. Right, so in Keats, the autumn, we find the season of autumn used to symbolize the autumn in a person's life. So in that way, that poem can be used to show that the romantics were expressly nature poets. They described or enjoyed nature. Yes, any questions? Any other questions? You can unmute your mics now. Right. Okay, then shall we move on to Byron? He was another English poet and perhaps the most famously celebrated, in the sense the most flamboyant poet flamboyant of all English romantic poets. Right? Had a very notorious, notorious, very loud and outstanding love life, a personal life which was very colorful. So his life itself drew attraction from the audience as much as his poetry. Although he was a romantic and he himself broke away from tradition sometimes, actually he experimented with various verse forms, right? He did not, he tried many verse forms, he did not stick to any one, but he wrote in many verse forms. And just although he was, we called him a romantic poet, he was an admirer of called the Augustan poems, notably Alexander Pope. So the elegance of that poet, that we find in those poems, have influenced the poems of Byron. Right? If we take the poem, "She Walks in Beauty." So in the very title itself, "She Walks in Beauty." Right? The poet does not say that, of course, she is a beautiful woman, or he doesn't say she is beautiful, but he says she walks in beauty. Beauty is personified, it is brought forward, and she herself walks in the sense, maybe physically walking, really walking, but also she lives in beauty. So everything about her life is beauty, beautiful. The beauty of the poem, why it is so much included in many anthologies, is due to its presentation as much as its theme. Right? Of course, he describes the beauty of the lady, but at the same time, this is not a conventional beauty. It is an inner beauty as well as outer beauty. Right? She lives in beauty. She walks her life in beauty. Beautiful. She walks in beauty like the night of cloudless times and star skies. So just as a cloudless sky which is filled with stars, what does it signify here? When there are clouds, the scene becomes, the night becomes obscure. So it is not an obscure or a stuffy night, it's a very clear night. Why does he use night, perhaps? Perhaps to signify silence, right? Elegance, poise, grandeur. With night, we get all those feelings. Elegance, poise, grandeur, right? All those qualities are brought out with the image of night. And the starry skies, illumined by the stars. So there isn't, it's not gaudy day here, not there is no bright and bashful light, right? A very silent person maybe, does not make a very big noise. And the starry skies of light only as necessary, not too much light as in day, right? The day, the night is brightened only by the stars, and all that's best of dark and bright meet in her aspect and her eyes. Right? So, as I mentioned earlier, light and darkness are meeting here. The right amount of everything, the right amount of light from the stars, and the right amount of darkness because it's night. Right? So they meet this specific time of the day. Whereas in daytime, you don't have darkness, right? But in night, you have both light and day. So they meet together. There is perfect harmony, there's perfect balance between light and darkness in this lady. Thus mellowed to that tender light, which heaven to gaudy day denies, not gaudy. Heaven does not allow this kind of beauty today. We see a very bright and bashful day with all the noises and all the distracting activities of daylight. some animals are stirring at day. Most of the animals stir up at daytime and make awful noises. As perhaps you can see in this, you can hear in the background. The helicopters and the birds and the pendulums, all of them are making a huge noise, right? So it's a gloomy day. But in night, most of these noises are hushed. So it's a beautiful time of the day. Heaven denies this beauty to the daylight. Mellowed in the tender light. It's a very mellow beauty, graceful, tender, soft, right? Not bright and barefoot. So in the next stanza, he goes on to elaborate this beauty. It is not so much an outward beauty, right? But an inner beauty. One shade the more, one ray the less, and half impaired the nameless grace. So if it was one shade more, right, maybe if the beauty was one shade more or one ray less, then it would impair the beauty of this lady. But it is not, it's perfect, right? There's a perfect blend between night and day. Beauty and maybe it's a synthesis of inner beauty and outward beauty. They are so perfectly blended in this person. Or maybe Byron is talking about darkness and light. Maybe the dark qualities of the lady, no? We do not know. But the
sorry for the interruption. Yes. In the basic stanza, the poet is describing the physical appearance of that woman, no? He describes the light and dark coming together in her appearance, like he meets in her specs and her eyes. Is that the physical appearance or inner appearance?
Yeah, it is the physical appearance. Now there is nothing to say in the first two lines, in the first two stanzas, that there is no evidence to say that he is describing the inner beauty of the person.
He also compares the woman to that night with the bright stars. Is that so? That he
compares the lady to the blending of dark and bright, the best of dark and the best of bright. So the perfect, the synthesis of both light and dark aspects, they meet in her eyes. That is what he says. Is it clear?
Yeah.
So thus meet in her aspect and her eyes, thus mellow to that tender light which heaven to God lay. So there he is describing the physical beauty. One shade the more, one ray the less, had half imparted nameless grace. So that of the physical beauty, yes, or the outward appearance, it is neither less nor a shade more, neither a shade more nor a shade less. So it's perfect. But then the synthesis is perfect. And the nameless grace, right? So that language is very beautiful. Words like grace, not beauty here, right? But grace, maybe the attraction, right? Which waves in every raven field or softly lightens over her face. Now what does this mean? One shade the more, one ray the less, had half impaired the nameless grace, which waves in every raven tress. Sorry, which waves in every raven tress. Or softly lightens over her face, right? So it is now the way Byron is describing the lady using it. He is first and foremost describing the lady using images of darkness and light. So maybe he is using those images to show the say that she is elegant, right? As it is mentioned in the previous stanza. He is not creating a god image or a bright image of a beautiful lady. As in Shakespearean sonnet, where he says the flower is beautiful as the summer, right? So summer it has a beauty of its own, which is very busy, noisy, and loudly bright. But here it is very silent, elegant, right? That is what is highlighted in a night sky, right? others, that is the beauty that he sees in the lady. So maybe that is the beauty that he wants the reader to know, that his lover has, right?
Raven is a bird, no?
Raven is a bird, right? So
no,
the color of the dress, right? The dark hair, right? The raven dress, or softly lightens over her face. The hair, which is black, it, right? Softly covers her face, or it waves in the wind, and softly lightens light on her face, and where the face is, where thoughts serenely sweet express how pure, how dear their dwelling place. What is the dwelling place of the thought? The mind, right? So how sweet and how pure is the dwelling place? That means the mind. How pure is the mind? So it's a pure mind which is symbolized here. The dwelling place is the mind, right?
This is a metaphor, no?
Yes. Okay, yes. The metaphor, we can say, the thought express how sweet is the mind, the dwelling place, how sweet it is. And then the next stanza, and on the cheek and over that brow, so soft, so calm, yet eloquent, the smiles that win, the things that glow. But not a very bright, not a very bashful, image of a woman, but a very elegant lady, right? In softness and in a poise, right? The things, right? Not very, not too much, not too less. Not a simple lady as such, but not a very, not a very attractive, not a very outstanding person as such, but a very silent, elegant person. The smiles that win, the things that glow, but tell of days in goodness spent. So there is the image of goodness. She has spent her days in goodness, characterized by virtue. A mind at peace with all below, a heart whose love is innocent, right? No, the love is innocent, maybe she is maybe inexperienced in love, or maybe at the same time not carnal love, right? The love is innocent, not a physical love, but a love which is innocent, a heart which is full of goodness, and a mind where the thoughts are pure, right? So now here in those last lines, we see the inner qualities of the lady described. Day spent in goodness, a love which is innocent, and a mind where pure thoughts dwell. So that is the inner beauty of the lady. And that beauty is compared to the time of night, where everything is neat, where light and darkness meet together in perfect harmony, in perfect blend. Right? So it's the poem where language is very perfectly handled to bring out the theme. It's very characteristic of a poem of the Augustan age, like in a very elegant in tone and perfect in form and in every way. Like in the careful choice of words, in, for example, cloudless climes and starry skies, right? Soft sounds in those lines, neat in her aspect and her eyes, right? The softness of the soft vowel sounds bring out the soft beauty of the lover. Serenely sweet express, right? Thought serenely sweet express, softly lightens over her face. The F and S sounds again. See how impaired the nameless phrase. That is why I said that words are carefully chosen. The poetic diction is very refined and rich. So overall, the theme of this poem is about the beauty of a person, is not so much in the outward appearance, but also it is highlighted. Beauty is brought about by the inner qualities of a person. It is the inner qualities of a person which makes a person beautiful. That is the theme of the poem. The inner beauty, the purity of thought, the virtuous existence, the innocence, and peace. Right? Peace is all below. Peace, innocence, goodness. These are the qualities which makes a person beautiful. And when it comes to the poetic devices, the form is perfect, right? And the careful choice of words, the poetic diction brings renders the poem a very elegant tone. There's an elevated tone in the poem. If you compare this poem to a simple poem like My Heart Leaps Up When I See a Rainbow, this is a simple poem. There's a deep philosophy, of course, but that this poem is very elegant. Right? And there is the music of the poem through the vowel, soft vowel sounds in between the lines. And see, even in the W sounds here, the brow, the tints that glow, the smiles that win and the tints that glow, a mind at peace with all below, the W sounds, soft vowel sounds, render a musicality, a soft musicality to the tone of the poem. And images, rich images, right? Rich and rare of images are used. Cloudless climes and the starry skies. The tender light, right? Also, there's a small comparison brought out with the gaudy day, right? So he is maybe comparing the beauty of his lady, this lady, with other ladies who are maybe outwardly very beautiful, but not so much, but do not possess so many good qualities. So that may be the gaudy day, right? There's a slight comparison there as well. And the raven thrust. And then on the cheek and the brow, the tints that glow, right? All these... Yeah, which one? Where is the personification used?
The smiles that wins.
Yes. Yes. Smiles that win. Smile is
sweet. Sweet express.
Yes.
Heaven to which heaven to. Denied.
There's some personification. Heaven denies the day, the beauty of the night, right? So heaven is personified. The thoughts express how dear is their dwelling place. So the thoughts are personified. Smiles that win the tints and glows. The tints and the smiles are personified. Right? Perfect rhyming scheme also adds to the musicality of the poem. And images which are carefully chosen to highlight the unique beauty of the lover. Not common images, but carefully chosen images. The things that glow, the smiles that win.
Smile is a symbol of inner beauty, no? Reflection of her thoughts and feeling.
Yes, right? So maybe other poets did not comment on the smile, right? So the smile brings out innocence, the beauty of the person. The tender light, right? The mellow tender light. Those images are carefully chosen to show the balance, the perfect harmony. How this lady is carrying herself with perfect balance. Not so much the outward appearance, but her nature itself. which is good, right? Virtuous at the same time, how she synthesizes, maybe say, good and even how he, how she carries her body at the same time, how she conducts her life, right? So when we say that she walks in beauty, right? The image that we get is not a girl who is sitting down or who is standing under a tree, right? Walk is a very straight up, we get a very straight upward, how he carries her body, right? A strong pose there. And also she walks in beauty, she walks through life beautifully. That is also an underlying meaning. She has spent her days beautifully, honored, respected in society, right? Untarnished, beauty, maintained a good character. All that comes out through the phrase walks in beauty, walks in goodness. Right? So that, through that phrase, a lot of things are brought out. So the language, as you can say, while the images are carefully chosen, the language is very rich in meaning. There are subtle meanings that are brought out through the word, like walks and means, body.
She walks means that the poet is fascinated, inspired by the beauty of that lady. She was attracted, no?
Yes.
And suddenly he says that she walks in beauty.
Yes, of course. Maybe he quickly noted this walk, no? Maybe he quickly saw it. But at the same time, if you see, if someone says she walks in beauty, that means she walks through life very elegantly, with a good character, with good virtue, how she is balancing and carrying her life. That is what the image that we get with walk. The word walk evokes all those images.
Maybe she walks in a crowd or in a party.
Maybe she walks in a crowd. So maybe it's she now. Okay, a poet sees her in a crowd and he notices her, how she is outstanding or different from the other ladies. Right? So maybe that is the meaning as well. Okay, any more questions from that poem? No questions? If you have any questions or if you have not understood anything, please let me know, right? Did all of you hear? I saw that someone had said that sometimes nothing is clear. So when I upload the video, I think you will be able to do that. You will be able to hear the video clearly, because I think in the video or in the recording, almost all things are clear, right?
My suggestion is that it is better to have your class in the room, in a covered place where the sound is very good.
No, I don't think that's possible, because our house is very open. And this is like a very open house. Are the sounds disturbing that much?
Not that much. I suggest it to get it better.
No, it will not become better. And then there's the problem of the internet connection, because the walls are very thick. That is why the outdoor spot is chosen. We will try to shift it to the maybe to 8:30, right? Because as the day progresses, the noises become louder. So I'll see whether I can bring it next week. So next week we will be having the assignment for 40 minutes, followed by the American poets. Starting from Robert Frost, Emily Dickinson, and who else is there? Yes, he's an Irish poet. Right? If we can, we will finish W.D. Yeats.
Another poet, no? Robert Forrest and Navy Dixon.
If I can, I will finish off W.D. Yeats, right? I will finish him off before we move on to the American poets, right? So next week we will do the assignment and we will discuss Yeats poems, right? If we have time, we will discuss a past paper question or another question as well. So the assignment will be based on either Shakespeare's poems, romantic poems, yes, only those ones. The first three questions.
What about the metaphysical poems?
Sorry?
The metaphysical poems also you said.
Metaphysical, Shakespeare's mm-hmm. poets, metaphysical mm-hmm. poets, and romantic poets. If we call metaphysical poets, we had only John Donne, isn't it? So since he is the only one who is in the syllabus, base your answer only on John Donne. But if you can read some other metaphysical poets, especially like Andrew Marvel, To His Coy Mistress. That is a nice poem, which is similar to John Donne. None of the other metaphysical poets have witty arguments or like that humor or that same argument. The conceit, metaphysical conceit, is not so much exploited by other poets. But of course, you can study.
So it will be based on Shakespeare and romantic poems, no?
No, metaphysical poems, that's it. All three groups, metaphysical, Shakespearean poems, and then the romantic poems, right? So be prepared for all three. I am not telling you that I will, I will include the contextual question as well. So be familiar with all poets, and also I noted that some of you are not familiar with Coleridge's poem. Are there any problems with that? With Coleridge's poem, it's a bit long, but please go through it and be familiar with it, because the question might be solely based on that, right? I might give a question which asks you to solely analyze one poem. For example, it might be write an analysis of Samuel Taylor Coleridge's Frost at Midnight, right? So I'm not sure what I will give you, but be ready for all poems and be familiar with the content of all of it, right? So if you don't have any questions, shall we wind off the session for now? Okay, right. So then see you again next Saturday at 8:30, right? I will let you know the time, but we'll keep it for 8:30 for now, right? If there are any changes, I'll let you know. Right, so see you again next week then. Goodbye.